Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Let's pray. God, thanks for today. Thanks for this time that you set aside for us to sit and think and ponder, reflect on your word and on the world around us. I pray that you give us eyes to see and ears to hear, you at work, wherever that may be, in our lives and in the cosmos. Amen.
Amen.
All right, so we're talking about incarnation, and today we're talking about incarnation in the early church. We're a bit behind, we're sort of 1 week behind, but also we'll slide into incarnation and the cosmos, because these two things fit together very well. The early church tended to think about Jesus not just in terms of like a person and a body, but also to think of Jesus in terms of the divine world and in terms of the entire cosmos. So we'll get to how all three of those things link up over today. So the early church was faced with some big questions and problems. If you read the New Testament really carefully, as we did with Paul last week and the week before, there's a lot of talk about Jesus, there's talk about the Holy Spirit, there's talk about God, but it's not systematic. That is, Paul doesn't seem to have everything hammered out in philosophical terms about how Jesus relates to God. That is, Paul is really sure that Jesus is God's son, that Jesus is closely related to God, that Jesus is the one through whom God brought salvation to the world. He's really clear about that. But exactly how Jesus relates to God, like physically, or how you put that into like a chart form, Paul's not big into charts, he just kind of talks. So in any event, the early church had not yet really figured out exactly. If you went up to Paul and asked him, how does Jesus relate to God? He'd have had a big, long answer for you, but it wouldn't have been the one that we say today in church. That is, it took about 300 years for Christians to develop the ideas behind the person of Jesus, who is Jesus, and the Trinity, that is, who is God. Those questions took a long time to formulate. I think they're in, like what we have now, Paul would listen to and say, wow, that's really interesting. Paul wouldn't say that's stupid, or where did you get those ideas? Paul would probably say, wow, you thought a lot more than I did about those questions. Paul's a lot more interested in day-to-day life than he is in answering sort of abstract questions about the nature of God. So there are two categories of questions that the early church started to really hear a lot of people ask. That is, Romans would ask, what the heck are you talking about? Explain your religion to me. Or Jews would say, how are you Jewish but not Jewish? Or how does your religion, the religion of Jesus, relate to what I believe? That is monotheistic Judaism. And so Christians had to answer two basic questions. The first was a Christological question. That is, who is Jesus? So Jesus was a person, but also a lot of Christians, especially by the time of the Gospel of John, start to talk about Jesus in terms of something that existed before the human part of Jesus existed. That is, Jesus is divine in some way. So now you have a problem, because you got human nature of Jesus and a divine nature of Jesus. And how do those things interact or overlap? Or there's a lot that's actually probably more answers to this question than people imagine. So one group of early Christians start to say, well, Jesus' body is just hologram, like Star Trek, it's just a hologram. It doesn't really exist. So if you put your hand through Jesus' head, it just like disappear, whatever, you know. The reason is that some early Christians are Greco-Roman people, and they believe, like lots of Greeks and Romans do, that the world is kind of dirty and disgusting. The physical world is gross. Remember back to the days when you read Plato in undergrad or something, right? The world of ideal forms is the good world. Good stuff is beyond this world. We are all the material world is like a shadow of a true good world, which is beyond material form. So the earth is gross and kind of disgusting and dirty. And Paul even talks in some of these terms too. In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul talks a lot about the resurrection, like what is the resurrection, how does it work? And Paul's like, well, you get this kind of better body. Like we have kind of a body of fleshly stuff, but there's this kind of like awesome body you're gonna get later, like at the resurrection, which is gonna be better. So he's using this dichotomy between the earth is kind of gross, there's better stuff outside of the earth. A lot of early Christians were ascetic, that is that they thought that like the body is bad in many ways, and you need to like kind of tame earthly desires. And so monks went out in the wilderness to try to like make sure they didn't care about anything or want anything. You exterminate desire in your body, and that's because the world is a bad place. This is part of what motivates that kind of activity. So those folks also liked to say, well, Jesus wasn't really fully a person, because that if Jesus, God becomes a person, then you get all this God stuff and the gross earthly stuff that are mixing. So So there are some people who say either that Jesus wasn't really a human, Jesus was just like a picture of a human or something like that, or that Jesus was like a shell of a person, like Invasion of the Body Snatchers, that God was the brain part of Jesus, and like the human part of Jesus was like the gross and dirty, disgusting part that God was kind of like using and like manipulating, like moving around. Those early Christian ideas didn't end up winning out. Those were in some way, they stuck around for a long time. In fact, sometimes they're kind of used in the late Middle Ages. But what we call Orthodox Christianity won out by the time of the early church councils, which we'll talk about in a minute, the 4th century. So there's another side where people would say, well, maybe we should put the emphasis on the other side. Maybe Jesus was really kind of more like a person, or even more like an angel than God. That is, this is kind of the opposite way of dealing with the same problem. Maybe Jesus was created, something that was made, but a special person. Or Jesus was like just a person that was adopted by God as a special person and then used as a special tool for salvation. So this is another group of Christians. They're often all lumped into one group called the Arians. Not Arians with a Y like Nazis. Arians, A-R-I-A-N, like Arius. So we'll talk about them in a minute too. He was just a guy, a Christian, who said, well, Jesus was probably created. Jesus was like a super angel that ended up helping the salvation of the world. So early Christians also, by and large, end up rejecting this point of view, although it takes a few centuries of fighting. So we end up with the kind of Nicene creeds we have it as a result of all of these fights. There's another group of fights that goes on, not just about Jesus, who is, how does the divine and human person of Jesus relate? But this is actually a bigger fight about how does God work? Because if you're a Jew from the first century, then you'd say, well, there's just one God, and that's just it. There's just God. It's monotheism. Now, Paul is talking about how there's like Jesus, and he's kind of God too, but then there's also God, like God the Father and Jesus, and how do those two things relate? And then you also have this thing, the Holy Spirit, that the New Testament starts to talk about, and Paul starts to talk about too, that it's like a thing that is real and a part of God and does stuff that like God like sends the Holy Spirit to do stuff, and that's God, so they're different. So now you have these three parts of God, right? God, or the Father, as this God is, part of God is often called, and then Jesus, and then the Holy Spirit. So early Christians fight about these things too. Some say the Holy Spirit is not a real important thing. It's a created thing, or it's just like an aspect of God. Some people say that these are just three parts of God. Some people say these are three different gods. All sorts of things that people say in the early church. So the early church hammers out these answers to these Trinitarian questions, and by the time of the church councils, in the 5th century, yeah.
When did the metaphor of God as a father get started? How?
Yeah, so I mean, I think that goes way back to like the earliest written stuff we have in like ancient Sumer, so like way before anything associated with Christianity or Judaism was around. And that's the earliest stuff we have about the gods is that they're imaged in Mesopotamian tradition as a family. And we see this actually like all over the place. Wherever we find kind of indigenous religions, there tend to be some familial aspects to it. So that is that there's a father god and a mother god and children gods. So if we look at ancient Babylonian mythology, ancient Egyptian mythology, ancient Greek mythology, all of those have roots that predate and are different from Judaism. All of those have, you know, so Zeus and Hera are like married, right?
Yeah.
So they're the children of Cronos. So like the gods are a family, and there is a father god. Now what's unique, I think, about Israel and its place in the world is that it ends up saying over time, well, there aren't all these other gods, there's just one god. And so that god is called father, but also because you've gotten rid of the mother god, the mother goddess, the father god also takes on mother god's characteristics. So it's a very interesting and unique thing that happens in ancient Israel. So like in the book of Job, chapter 38, there's a creation story, and God has a womb and gives birth to creation. Or in Isaiah, chapters 50 through 66, chapters 40 through 66, there's a whole lot of images about God as a mother. God has breasts. God weans like Israel. So in any event, God has a womb in those texts as well. So there's a lot of divine mother imagery that finds its way into ancient Israelite tradition. So the father god, because the ancient world like today is a patriarchy, so that tends to have supremacy of imaging. But one thing I always point out to my students is, translations and things always refer to God as he. Like this, you know, if you read the NRSV, it'll be like, you know, every time it talks about God, it'll talk about God as a he. That's actually a very, it's a very ancient Babylonian way of talking about God. So in any event, but this, you know, ancient Israel is in a way unique, in part because their God has androgynous characteristics. But still, people talk about God the Father a lot, including Paul and Jesus. So does that make sense, or does that help at all? Yeah. So this big question, we're not going to be able to solve these questions today, but just to give you a basic idea of where we go with this, the answer to this question that the church says is that Jesus is both fully human and fully divine, and that's a paradox, and we have to deal with that. That's the way the early church ends up coming up with answering this question. And this question is, it's a paradox, all three of them are God, and they're not all exactly the same, but they're not exactly different. And there you go. that's the paradox of the Trinity. So they end up really formulating these paradoxical ways, but also trying to give equal weight to both of these groups. And if you've ever heard about the split between the East and the West, so the Eastern Orthodox Church and the Western Catholic Church split right around the year 1000 AD, and they split over the Holy Spirit. So when we say in our Nicene Creed that the Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son, that part "and the Son" is an addition to the creed that got put in right around the year 1000 in basically the Roman-controlled areas. That was put in because people said that they didn't want the Spirit to be subordinated or Jesus to be kind of lesser than the Father. So they wanted like basically the Spirit to be like kind of from the Father and the Son. The Eastern Orthodox churches, they said, nope, Jesus comes out of God the Father, the Holy Spirit comes out of God the Father, and God the Father is actually kind of like higher than these. These are like emanations, almost like the two hands that come out of the brain. That this is Jesus, this is the Holy Spirit, and they do God's work. So that fight ended up really eventuating in the split, along with a lot of political concerns. But anyway, so these fights are still kind of alive and ongoing today. But truth be told, like no one really has a good answer to any of them. But there's still interesting and good things I think to think about. So this is a picture, this is from the Eastern Orthodox tradition, this is from hundreds of years, maybe even 1,000 years after the event. It depicts an event that you all are going to love in just a minute. This is a guy named Arius. Arius was, according to all sort of recollections of the time, a winsome speaker, a very kind man, a generous man, someone who was an ascetic monk, so was not after money or glory. He taught that Jesus was created. And he lived right around the year 300 CE or AD. So Arius was teaching that Jesus was created, Jesus was kind of lesser than God and so on. And he's one of his famous sayings was, there was a time when he was not. There was a time before Jesus. So Arius, this is a part of Arius's like much broader teachings, and this is important to him because in a way he wants us to become like Jesus. And for him, if Jesus is like just God, like way above us, there's no way we can become like Jesus. So it's a way for Arius sovereign saying, well, I can't be like Jesus, so I can just be like however I want. It's a way to like sort of wish away your like just needs to be, you know, any sort of ethical command on yourself. Like, you know, I need to be a good person because I can be better. Pelagius is another person who does the same thing. He says, well, if you can be good, you can try to be good. The church is always really gets worried about that. But anyway, does anyone know who this guy is who came up and walked up to Arius and punched him in the face? St. Nicholas.
Oh my God.
St. Nick, yeah, this is St. Nick. Like Christmas, like Santa Claus. Yeah, Santa Claus is famous for punching Arius in the face at a big meeting because St. Nick was so upset that he said that Jesus was created. Jesus was created, Jesus is God, and God be created. Boom. And he decked him. So in any event, but Arius' teachings were highly influential, and Arius ended up being exiled, really kicked out of the areas that were controlled theologically by what's now called the Orthodox Church, and he ended up going up and basically into Germany, into France, Gaul, areas that weren't controlled by the Roman Empire. He ended up converting almost all these folks, and the Slavs and so on, and they all were converted to Arian Christians. He also talked to Visigoths, people in Spain. He ended up converting all of these pagan groups, but they all became non-Orthodox Christians. So the Roman Church became associated with sort of Orthodox Christianity. And it took centuries, really, for the Orthodox Church to win out theologically and politically. We'll get to that story in just a moment. But just so you know, the early church was, part of this argument was rooted in the Bible, and part of the Bible's way of talking about creation and God, and as early Christians read it, about Jesus. So if you open with me to the book of Proverbs, it's maybe a third of the way through your Bible. If you open up to any of the historical books, like 1 Kings, 2 Kings, 1 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles, keep going. If you open up to Psalms or Job, keep going. If you get to any of the prophets, you've gone too far, wait, go back. Proverbs chapter 8 is a fascinating text. And it really informed a lot of early Christian discussions about Jesus. So, of course, early Christians see the scriptures of ancient Israel as being authoritative for them. You can see this like in the Gospel of Matthew, when basically all the Christians are going through, like, trying to find explanations for who Jesus is in the Old Testament. So one of the places that they go is creation language, because they're trying to figure out, like, where was Jesus? Was Jesus around the creation or not? And you and I tend to think of Genesis 1 and 2 and 3 basically as being the creation story, which we talked about before. That's actually two different creation stories. But on top of that, there's actually a bunch of other creation stories in the Old Testament, and they're all different. And the early Christians knew this. So they tended to go to other creation stories rather than Genesis 1 and 2 to try to find images of Jesus. Now, Proverbs is an interesting book. The first 9 chapters are one big, long poem that actually don't have any proverbs in them. Like, most of you open up to the middle of Proverbs, and it's like, you know, be a good person, like, save your money, you know, stuff like that. But the beginning of the book of Proverbs is one big, long poem that's trying to convince you that there really is, like, a right way to live your life, and God wants you to live a life of peace and justice and happiness and contentment. Anyway, God wants you to treat your family well and things like this. And it's all set within the story. It's like basically there's an assumed world of Proverbs 1 through 9 where you're a child and your two parents are trying to teach you about how to be good. And in this story, the mother and the father talk to you, the child, about two women. Woman wisdom and woman folly. So in other words, like, there's two paths to life, right? You can be wise or you can be stupid. This is the whole point of the book of Proverbs. There are stupid decisions and good decisions, right? So these two women represent these two points of view, or these two choices, these two paths that you can follow in your life. And both of these women are calling out to you, hey, my way's better. Like, they're both trying to, like, they're, you know, sort of advertising their way. Come join my way. Like, being good is great. Or, like, you know, stealing from people is awesome. You know, like, so Dame Folly and Woman Folly, Woman Wisdom. Are constantly trying to get your attention. And in chapter 8, there's a big long speech by Woman Wisdom, who's calling to you and saying, please listen, like, listen to me. I have a better way than she does. And in chapter 8, verse 22, all the way through verse 31, there's a big long sort of story, really, it's a poem, that Woman Wisdom says about herself and where she was at the moment of creation. So this is another creation story, different than Genesis 1. And Woman Wisdom says, verse 22, the Lord, so God, created me at the beginning of his work, the first of his acts long ago. So, the Lord created me. That word created can be translated a bunch of different ways, unfortunately. Like, lots of biblical stuff. This looks simple, but it's not. That word created actually is gave birth. It's heel. It's a word that means to be, like, in birth pangs. So God, like, gave birth to me at the beginning of his work. The first of his acts long ago, ages ago, I was set up at the first, before the beginning of the earth. When there were no depths, that is, when there was no, like, big water, watery mass, I was brought forth. When there were no springs abounding with water. Before the mountains had been shaped, before the hills, I was brought forth. When he had not yet made earth or fields, the world's first bits of soil. When he established the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle in the face of the deep, when he made firm the skies above, when he established the fountains of the deep, when he assigned to the sea its limit, so that the waters might not transgress his command. When he marked out the foundations of the earth, there then I was beside him like a master worker. I was daily his delight, rejoicing before him always, rejoicing in his inhabited world and delighting in the human race. This is a story about woman wisdom, the principle of wisdom for all the cosmos. The way that the world is organized is another way of thinking about this. All justice, all truth, all peace, all love, all good things, and also all the, like, rules of the universe are bound up in this one character. And God got me a long time ago. God made me, and then I helped set up the whole world. I was like a master worker building the world. So this character of woman wisdom is hugely important in both Jewish and Christian tradition. In Jewish tradition, they understand woman wisdom to be the Torah. God's construction, you know, book, like, you know, instruction book for the world. And in Jewish tradition, the Torah, it contains all the secrets of the universe and so on. In Christian tradition, this is understood as Jesus, of course, this external thing that is sort of like God that helps to make the world. And you can see how Arius, someone who wants to talk about Jesus being made, says, ah, God birthed me or created me at the beginning of God's work. So early Christians say, well, that's metaphorical, or something like that. A lot of early Christians who want to defend the Orthodox position. But this idea of woman wisdom is hugely influential in early Christian tradition, and it's influential in the Gospels. So we can see that this character, woman wisdom, appears in the New Testament. We can see her appear in the Gospel of John. John talks about woman wisdom, the principle for all the organization of knowledge and wisdom and truth and goodness or whatever in the universe, as the Logos. So you turn to John chapter 1, the Gospel of John, Matthew, Mark, and John. John chapter 1 is a retelling of Proverbs 8, chapter 8, verses 22 through 31 that we just read. And it's a Christian retelling of it. You know, it's a slightly different. In the beginning was the Word. Now, this is the Greek word logos, which for Greek folks who had any knowledge of philosophy, which would be, you know, Paul and John, and these folks who are writing this stuff, they have an understanding of Greco-Roman thought. That word logos doesn't just mean a word, or can. It can mean like a word that I say. But generally, in sentences like this, means the principle of all knowledge and wisdom and insight and truth and so on. It's the thing, all the logic of the entire cosmos. It's what Plato's looking for, the logos. He wants to find out how everything's working. And you could find this through knowledge in Greek thought. This is a retelling of this story because in the Christian version, it's not just way out there and you can only reach it with your mind. The Logos came to us. The whole principle of truth and love and goodness and the whole cosmos became human. Right. So this is sort of a retelling of both a Greek myth and of Proverbs chapter 8. In the beginning, so before there was all this stuff or anything existed, there was the Word, the Logos, the principle of truth and love and goodness and so on. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So here we have a retelling of this, you know, woman wisdom was next to God at the beginning of creation. She was with God and so on. And then we have this other step. This is God, though. So John's adding a little bit more to the story of Proverbs 8. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him. And without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life. And the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. This idea of Jesus as woman wisdom. But wait, you know, so how is Jesus woman wisdom and so on? John, sorry, we'll get to Paul in just a minute. John continues and goes on. Question?
God's parade.
Oh, okay, yeah.
God's
parade. So go back to verse 10 of chapter 1 of John. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him. Yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or the will of flesh, or the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us. And we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. And then verse 16, we'll skip a little bit about John. From his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. The law indeed was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. It is God, the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart, who has made him known. So here we have some of that hedging that's consistent in the early church, that like there's God and then there's Jesus, and there's a little bit of wiggle room there. So Jesus is God, is with God, but also no one's ever seen God. People have seen God's Son, that's Jesus. So there's still some more to be worked out in the early church. He uses the Gospel of John chapter 1 a lot to try to work through this logic of the incarnation. But here we have this kind of classical Christian understanding of the incarnation. That this, what became like real human like flesh, like the sarx is the Greek word for this, and it's the gross human flesh stuff. Like the Logos beyond became the gross human flesh stuff, and lived among us, and lived among us. So the Word became flesh and lived among us. That word in Greek is to tabernacle, set up a tent. Like God became this Word, this divine principle of the organization of the universe, became literally flesh and bones, and set up a tent among us and dwelt among us for a little while. And through this being, we could see the glory of God. Which, like, you can't really see God's glory. This is a big thing in the Old Testament, right? Like, Moses can only see God's butt. Remember that story where, like, God has to pass by and God covers Moses' face, and then when God is, like, he can see the backside of God, which literally is the Hebrew word for, like, for deer ear. So anyway, he sees God's butt. This idea that we're seeing kind of the trailing of God's glory filtered through a human body. So this is who Jesus is. Now, the other Gospels are not entirely sure about what to do. Like, John is the one Gospel that makes this kind of philosophical statement or theological statement about the incarnation. It goes a bit beyond what any other Gospel does. Mark says that Jesus is God's Son, and he's powerful, but it just doesn't try to make a statement like this. So the early church keeps going back to John, and really John's interpretation of woman wisdom to try to understand Jesus. And we can see this as well. This is what we call the cosmic Christ in kind of theological circles. This idea of understanding Jesus continues throughout some of Paul's work. And Paul's independent of John, so we think this is like kind of a brother. John's not making this stuff up. In other words, it's out there in the early Christian tradition. So if you turn with me to 1 Corinthians 1. We actually read 1 Corinthians 1 a couple weeks ago, but I'm going to show you another little part of it now. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Verse 18, how the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. We talked about this and how for any Roman, a weak God who got crucified on the cross would have been a very stupid God to worship. And Paul is talking about wisdom here. Verse 20, where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. So God's principle of wisdom decided that people were not obeying the call of, like, hey, like, you know, basically Plato was like being really smart, but didn't help people understand God any better. So God had to appear through foolishness, the foolishness of the cross. But this is, again, woman wisdom who's appearing through the foolishness of the cross. Like, God's principle of divine wisdom is how Paul is deciding to talk about Jesus.
How did the gender change? How did Jesus become male?
This is not something that people really ever talk about in the New Testament, or even in the early church. I mean, my guess is that they just, you know, they tend to think, well, of course, Jesus, you know, God came as a guy. There's a lot of gender essentialism in the early church, and a lot of gender, patriarchy in the early church that tends to dominate. At the same time, there are resources in the New Testament tradition, just like there are resources in the Old Testament, to help us to think more than that, or past that, or rethink that. So the way that in the early church, women actually did have lots of roles, that women were preachers, women were teachers, women were deaconesses, women were in charge of a lot of the stuff in the early church. Over time, the church ends up reifying patriarchal control. But I think these are ways for us to help unthink that. Now, why did the New Testament never anywhere, nor the Old Testament, talks about, like, why would God be, if God decided to become flesh, why would God become a man? It's just not something that they tend to think about. So yeah, I mean, in other words, I don't find we can talk about that, and that's a great thing, a great question to ask, but Paul doesn't really dwell on that very much.
Yeah. Is that unusual? I mean, we're in other indigenous religions, and, you know, Greek temples and things, women have roles there as well, or was this?
So this is the weird thing, is that in Greek tradition, but I mean, really, now I'll talk about the kind of ancient Near Eastern tradition, and like the Levant, so like the Phoenicians and the Israelites, but also the folks in Egypt and the folks in Babylon. Those folks tended to have gender segregated, so like the Vestal Virgins in Rome too. Like, women tended to have certain jobs that they performed at religious ceremonies and services that tended to be associated with women goddesses. So the same is true in Mesopotamia. Like, there are priestesses and female prophets of Ishtar, like the female god of war in ancient Mesopotamia. In ancient Israel, it was a masculine job to be a priest. There were women prophetesses, though. So Huldah is one woman in 2 Kings 22:23 who, like, has a big job. We know that there were women prophetesses that are outside of the tradition. Over time, it becomes a more masculine-dominated tradition, and some of those women get kind of almost edited out of the tradition. But we still see traces of them, like Deborah in Judges is a prophetess, and is the spiritual and religious and political military leader of Israel for a time. So there's a memory of that in Israel, but over time it becomes more patriarchal. So in any event, here in the early church, it was considered weird and unusual. I mean, the whole thing was weird and unusual. I mean, the first thing is that the Romans, you had to have a homeland to be an official religion, and Judaism was the religion of Palestine, of Judea, and Jerusalem. So like, if you said I come from Jerusalem, my religion comes from Jerusalem, but it's not exactly Jewish. The Romans are like already category error. Like, gods have places, and if your god doesn't have a place, like, who are you? And also they're like, well, our God doesn't actually tell us like that we have to act like Jews. Like, we can act totally differently. We can be Gentiles, but also worship the same God. And then Romans like, I don't get what like worshiping a God goes along with like a lifestyle and like choice of dress and food and whatever, you know, like all this, like you can be particular, but you all are particular and not. It's just totally bizarre. But also like the way that they formulated, like they don't have temples. The early Christians, they meet in homes and they have these cannibalistic feasts where they eat flesh, and the Romans are worried about this cannibalistic feast that the early Christians have, but also that there are like women and men that are mixed together, and that the women and men in positions of authority together, and women and men meet together to have these worship services. So early Christians, we know from letters that Romans write, they think that the early Christians are like the most depraved sexual addicts ever. Like, you all are like, oh my God, they must meet, they eat people's flesh together, and they have to have like lots of like just sex all the time when they meet, of course, because men and women, why else would men and women meet in the home and have these depraved rituals? So to them it's satanic, where actually the word that Romans use, good Romans use to talk about Christians, they're atheists. They've given up on the gods. They follow their desires. So, and of course, if you're like a Christian, you're like, what do they do? That's not what we do, right? From that perspective, you might see how Christians get thrown in the lions. They're different because they've given up on the gods. And they, you know, are. So in any event, we know that it would have been very strange simply because the Romans persecute and consider Christians outcasts precisely because of their the mixed gender faith, if that makes sense. So, in any event. Okay, so, but there are lots of other places we can go to look at the cross of Christ, but if you turn with me to Colossians, so if you're at 1 Corinthians and you keep turning, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, and then Colossians. Colossians chapter 1 is a deuteropauline or pseudo-pauline letter. That is, it's written in the name of Paul. It's written, I'm sure, by someone who was friends with Paul, or Paul was this person's mentor. It's written in the authority of Paul and in the tradition of Paul, but uses language that Paul doesn't seem to use ever in any of Paul's other writings that we know are from Paul. So in any event, it seems to be, it's got this person's twist on it. But so, look at verse 3 of Colossians. In our prayers for you, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. Now remember, this is a letter to a particular community, to the folks who live in Colossae, a big city in Greece. You have heard of this hope before in the word of the truth, the gospel that has come to you. Just as it is bearing fruit and growing in the whole world, so it has been bearing fruit among yourselves from the day you heard it and truly comprehended the grace of God. This you learned from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a fellow faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, and he has made known to us your love in the Spirit. So in other words, somebody has come from this city, this guy Epaphras, and has told whoever's writing this letter in Paul's name that the Colossians are doing great. And this is a letter to commend them in their faith. So verse 9, for this reason, since the day we heard it, we have not ceased praying for you and asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of God's will and all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you may lead lives worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him as you bear fruit in every good work and as you grow in the knowledge of God. May you be strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power. May you be prepared to endure everything with patience while joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption and forgiveness of sins. So some traditional Christian language that in this day and age would have been fairly new ways of thinking about how Jesus, what Jesus does. Jesus takes people and takes them from kind of power, being under the power of darkness, and we have been transferred to a place where we have forgiveness and redemption. We become new people in Jesus' image. And then verse 15, here's where the theological cosmic Christ comes in. So in order for us to understand how this works, how does redemption, salvation, everything work? Well, here's how it works, verse 15. He, that is Jesus, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. Now notice how this is harkening back to that language from Proverbs 8, verse 22. The firstborn, the first thing was born in all creation. So again, this is reading Proverbs chapter 8 to understand who Jesus is. And Jesus is the image of the invisible God. So you can't see God, but you can't see Jesus. And if Jesus doesn't look exactly like God, like maybe God doesn't have hands or hair or whatever, like feet. His life, his teachings or whatever are a way for us to see, to image God. He bodies forth God. For in him, verse 16, for in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, again from Proverbs 8, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. And you, who were once estranged and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, God is now reconciled in his fleshly body through death, so as to present you holy and blameless and irreproachable before him, provided that you continue securely established and steadfast in the faith, without shifting from the hope promised by the gospel that you heard, which is proclaimed to every creature under heaven. I, Paul, became a servant of this gospel. Okay, so this story that we see here, right, if you kind of read the story again, right, so Jesus is the distillation of God and an imaging of God in a way into a person's body. But then you get more than that. The whole universe, right? Verse 17, he himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. So this idea that the entire universe hangs together because Jesus is holding it together in some way. And then verse 19, for him, in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile himself to all things, earth and heaven. So this is a creation-wide account of Jesus, right? It's not just about human bodies or human souls or something. Jesus came just to save your soul. This is about the entire cosmos. And this is a slightly different way of thinking about the problem of the Christianity solves, right? I mean, so religions are all about problems and solving them, right? So like there's a, but how you conceive of the problem is, you know, sort of tells you how you're gonna solve it and so on. So part of the problem of Christianity is sin, right? A lot of people today too, in the ancient church did as well, like they internalize and personalize this problem. It's about me. It's about, like, I'm in hell, like, God's going to send me to hell because I did bad things, and you got to, Jesus, like, somehow, like, gets me, like, on the ledger book to, like, be in the good people group, and then I get to go to heaven or something like that. You know, almost like the show The Good Place, you know, whatever, have you seen that? It's a funny show about, like, the afterlife. But so, either you're a good person, you go to heaven, and God helps you through that if you're a good Christian, and, you know, bad people go to hell, so on. That's how a lot of people think of this kind of transactional salvation. Here we see that salvation, a lot of the early church tends to think about salvation not in terms of you as an individual, but in terms of all of creation. This is a creation-wide thing. And it has to do with not just people, but also with, like, everything in earth and in heaven. And when they're saying heaven, it means kind of the skies. Like, just everything that is tied up in this battle between darkness and light. Sin and salvation. And that Christ somehow becomes all of this stuff. So one way of thinking about this, it's not spelled through kind of carefully here, but one way of thinking through this is that maybe in Christ, God doesn't just become a human body, but God becomes stuff. And when God becomes stuff, God isn't just, it's not limited here, it spreads. Like, God becomes all the stuff. Like, God infects stuff with goodness. So this is an antidote to that Greco-Roman story about how the stuff of the earth is bad. And this also goes along with the understanding that this is a way to kind of overcome the problem of, like, how does God get, like, in a bad person's body, like me? You know, how does, you know, in other words, like, yeah, God kind of overturns how things work in the universe. So this is also tied up with, like, Christian concern over, and I don't know, I mean, of course, no Christians care about this today, but they did a long time ago. Christians were worried about sex and genitalia and then what people do with their genitalia. That was like a big deal, right? No, I know everyone's really, no one worries about that today. No, okay. So in the early church, they start to worry about, like, human body functions and stuff. And actually, Paul even is like worried about this. And Paul's just like, maybe we should just be celibate and like not get married and stuff, because like we're not really sure what Jesus says with our bodies. And you know what? We can see that this is an alternative way of thinking about how like God makes all things and everything is okay. Like God is making things okay, including our bodies, including the parts of our bodies that ancient people and modern people tend to sometimes fret about. Okay, so this concern over human bodies and the world itself and so on comes to a head at what we call the Council of Nicaea, where we get the beginnings of the Nicene Creed, which is a way for us to try to like say something together about God and about the world. The reason that we have a Nicene Council is that Constantine the Great, one of the emperors of Rome, sort of becomes a Christian. I say sort of because it's not clear exactly like what happened, but here's a coin of Constantine, and you can see there's a Christian Cairo symbol on top of the Roman insignia stabbing like the serpent of the devil. So he does begin, he adopts Christian uses of images and motifs and language. When he apparently has a vision of Christ before a big battle that he has over a rival emperor, the Empire of Rome had been split into four different parts, and Constantine ends up like killing all of his rivals one by one and unifying his control. And so this one battle, the Battle of Milvian Bridge, he conquers his enemy Licinius and ends up coming back into Rome. And he issues what's called the Edict of Milan, which is in 313 CE, and where he says basically Christianity is no longer a problematic religion. Like it's okay to be a Christian in the Roman Empire. Now the reason he probably does this is number one, he does probably think that like Jesus helped him to win that battle. So this is he's repaying the Christian God. Another reason is that like Christianity had become hugely important in the Roman Empire by this time. So Constantine was himself in Polish friends, powerful friends, by making Christianity okay in the Roman Empire. So there might have been a self-serving part of this. But in his defense, Constantine ends up becoming somewhat of a theologian. And he asks Christians all over the empire to explain Jesus to him. And he gets a million different answers. And he gets concerned. Because he's like, this person tells me this thing, that Jesus was created. This person tells me that Jesus is just God. This person tells me Jesus didn't have a body, it wasn't a real body. This person tells me that Jesus was just a guy. What do we do? You know, like, how do we rationalize this? And so he ends up calling a council. He gets all of the early bishops of the early church together. In fact, a lot of them didn't show up, but they sent envoys or letters even. The Bishop of Rome famously didn't show up, but sent a big letter explaining his point of view. And he called people together at a royal palace in Nicaea, which is right near Constantinople or modern-day Istanbul. And he gathered them all together and had them all hash it out. And Constantine showed up every day that he could to these meetings and actually like contributed and like you know was like, asking questions. And he seems to have been an Arian. He wanted the group that said that Jesus was created to win out. He lost. I mean, so Constantine actually lost his own council, which is amazing. But anyway, so during this council, I see they start to put together some ideas about who Jesus is. They hammer out some basic understandings, and also they start to develop the idea of heresy and anathematizing people. So in other words, in the early church, if you were wrong, or if I thought you were wrong about who Jesus was, we could still hang out together. We might even still worship together. Wasn't considered like evil to say that Jesus was created necessarily. If I believe that Jesus was God incarnate and you believe that Jesus was just a guy, we might still meet together and be in community. There's a guy named Athanasius who wasn't a bishop at the time, so he wasn't actually at Nicaea at all, in fact, but he was the kind of assistant to a bishop and wrote a bunch of letters to people telling them, hey, listen, at the Council of Nicaea, let's do this thing where we basically anathematize people. As we say, they're out of the community, they don't believe certain things. And this is the transition of Christianity to a religion of where there is something like an orthodoxy, that is, there's right beliefs. Christianity beforehand was more like what we would call an orthopraxis community, that is, you had to do certain things to be part of the community. You had to show up, you had to go through a catechism, you had to go be baptized, you had to participate in the breaking of bread, but also in the communal sort of mission, right? That was what mattered more. The Christianity switches here to being more of an orthodoxy. About right belief. You have to say the right things to be part of our community. Now, I'm proud to say that as Episcopalians, we're part of the group that in the early modern era decided to go back to a bit more of the orthopraxy model, right? We tend to de-emphasize orthodoxy. There aren't certain things you have to say to be part of our community. People here at this church believe lots of different things, in part that's because we're trying to, in a way, create a space where it's okay to say certain things, but what we care about is our common prayer. That's what unifies us, or what we do together. So, in any event, Athanasius, I tend to see him as a bad guy. Also, he was a gangster and had people murdered, so I see for that reason, too. But there are also good guys. I love Gregory of Nazianzus. He's the first ever abolitionist theologian. First person to say slavery was bad that we know of. Like, just evil, outright evil practice should never be done for theological reasons. In fact, he got that from the book of Ecclesiastes in all places. But Gregory of Nazianzus also had this great dictum, which I actually love, that that which is not assumed is not healed, but that which is united to the Godhead is saved. And this is his argument for Jesus that really won the day in the early church. So what he said was, if God didn't become an actual person, or some people in the early church said, well, Jesus became like a person but didn't have like the boy parts or the girl parts, like, because those are gross to early Christians, and like, you know, so Jesus like would just have like, he's like a Ken doll, you know, there's a smooth part down there, and they're like, I don't know how you went to the bathroom or whatever, but you know, whatever. But Gregory of Nazianzus said, God wants to assume and become all of us. Like, God doesn't think any of us is gross or disgusting, or like, all of you, the way you are, is great, and God in Jesus became that. So even like our personalities, like Jesus had a personality. He gets frustrated, he gets sad, he cries, he yells at people sometimes when he shouldn't. God became all of that. God assumed everything about you, but also like your desires. Like, Jesus felt desire for people. Maybe even desires that at the time would have been like worried about and concerned about, right? God assumes all of that, everything that goes into being a person. And for Gregory of Nazianzus, this explains the stuff in the Gospels where Jesus cries, or doesn't know things, or like, you know, feels frustrated and like throws stuff at people, or makes a court and beats people up, like, you know, with the turning over of the tables in the temple. Jesus is really a person and really God. And so the second part of the statement is another part that might worry some Protestants, but actually like Protestants have ended up saying, yeah, I actually agree with that too. And that's that because Jesus becomes fully human, all of humanity, and indeed all of the world, ends up becoming something like divine. Like, we're actually like, we're not, like, it's not just like God became like gross stuff and then now God's gross, but that kind of infected the world with divinity. And now, like, we're on our way to becoming divine. In other words, you don't belong in heaven, but now you can be there. Because you've been brought up into the Godhead, into divinity itself. So, in any event, thinking of Jesus as something that opens out divinity rather than like kind of keeps it in. We have people like Maximus the Confessor, an early church theologian from the 7th century in the 600s, who pushes this a bit further and says that God's divine energy, or energia, comes through Jesus and doesn't just end with the human race, but it actually continues out and flows out into the world. Trees and rocks and animals and everything else is now kind of infected with the divine energy and is deified. We don't have a whole lot of time left, and so I'll have to stop here, but I was just going to say, we can think about science, and we'll come back to this. Actually, so later on in the semester, we'll talk about biological evolution, evolutionary theory, and in Jesus, that is, if Jesus became a human, what is a human, and where does human begin and end? And so, in any event, just a lot of, did Jesus save Neanderthals? It's a really interesting question, and something that we'll actually come back to in terms of thinking about evolutionary biology. But also, I'll talk about cosmology then, too. In other words, like, what do we do with the creation of the world, the beginning of the world, the Big Bang, and everything like that? And I think there's a lot of interesting things that we can think about, but not today. So I'll get back to St. Augustine. We'll see that again. But I'll end with this. When we think about how God relates to stuff, this particular tradition, and again, this is not all early Christians, this isn't all modern Christians, this is one way of thinking about God, this cosmic Christ. This is what we might call pantheism or panentheism. It's kind of your choice about which how far you want to go with this. Typical theism or classical theism says that, you know, there's God and then there's stuff. God creates the universe. This cosmic Christ style of thinking about the incarnation, that is what happened when God became flesh, is, it pushes the boundary of that. It says, like, you know, God, creation became part of God. Humans became part of God, and the world maybe even became part of God. So panentheism is a theology that says that God exists, and the world exists, and the world exists as a part of a subset of God. Pantheism, of course, says that, like, God and the created order are exactly symmetrical, like they're exactly the same. So this says that there's something of God that's not also in the world. It's kind of outside of the element. And those two things, you can through this idea of the cosmic Christ, you can kind of get to both of those possible solutions to the problem. So other thoughts or comments or concerns about this way of thinking about God and stuff? The cosmic Christ, here's Dali's cosmic Christ. Jesus as the principle of all creation and the kind of summation of the universe. Way too much stuff to think about, sorry. I hope you have a blessed day being a part of God, and whenever you look around at the people that you see, you are looking at Christ.